Okay, so today is it's similar to the webinar. It's the exact same webinar we did about 2 months ago, but it's on the DSP Toolkit Update 2021. And the aim of this is obviously to help practices understand the requirements of the 2021 DSP Toolkit to help you prepare. The deadline is well, it's the end of June, it's June 30th, and that's the deadline for you to submit the toolkit. So to actually say, we've done all of this stuff and we're submitting it. The toolkit's the audit where you're basically saying, we've done all of this. So there is work to do. If you're just picking this up now and going, okay, I just need to fill out that thing and submit it at the end of June, there is work you need to do between now and the end of June. Specifically, the two major points which I'll be talking about throughout this webinar are a data security cyber test and having a log of that and an action plan in place based on the results of that test. And also you have potentially contract amendments or new contracts to issue. And for those of you who've been in practice for a while, you know that getting new contracts signed and back and forth and sometimes debated can take a while. So I think that there might be some urgent tasks that you need to get on top of now. Some of you probably sat there thinking, I've done that, Alex, that's fine. You released the documents in March, so we're on top of that. But just to sort of keep those key things in mind is it's not just about submitting the toolkit. It's about having done all the bits and adopted the new policies and the procedures and done the tests and the things that you need to do in order to be able to submit the toolkit to the standards required. And you've got a month to do that from now. I'll be talking about that more in the webinar, but I think it's really good to frame it at the beginning of the webinar, just that those are your two key takeaways from today. I'll just give a little bit of update and information and a little bit on what we're doing here at Agilio. I've talked about this in the last couple of webinars, but I think it's really good for our members. You know, CQC consultation update, the CQC are pretty much at the point where they are publishing. I think the CQC have slowed down a bit because we had the TMAs came in October. We've had a bit of an adjustment recently where they've started to do registration inspections again. And what they've also started to do is they're going into practices that they haven't ever inspected. And they're trying to be a bit more focused. So they're doing inspections based on the safe, effective and well-led key lines of inquiry. They're not doing caring or responsive for the minute. So they're doing sort of shorter, more focused inspections, but I think there's more change to come. I think what we're seeing right now is just sort of an interim, and what's happened is the CQC have consulted with the profession, have asked the profession some questions. Would we like ratings? What do we think of this? What do we think of that? They've sort of got their macro strategy, which is their strategy. The CQC strategy is something that's got to please a lot of stakeholders. It's got to be something that looks politically good to the general public. It's got to look good to the government. It's got to look good to healthcare. And strategy is the direction that you sail a ship. You say, we want to go in this direction. These are the great things we want to achieve. Once strategy is decided, it's then up to operations managers, like inspection managers, to go, okay, well, how do we translate that strategy into tangible actions? And the reason I'm saying this is because there's some people out there right now saying, we know how the CQC inspection is going to change. It's going to do this. It's going to do that. And I think there's some people out there trying to sell courses on it right now. You know, as the head of compliance here at Agilio, I can say no one knows yet. And the conversations that we've had with the CQC, they're very much saying, we've still got COVID. We're going to look at the strategy. We're going to look at the feedback that we've got from practices. And then we're going to formulate our plan. And then we're going to share our plan with the profession before we implement that plan. I've got an article that I've written on this, a two-part article. Part one should be coming out in the next week or so, which I'll probably just put on the website. We might mail it out. But just to give everyone just... nothing major is changing at the moment, and just be wary of anyone telling you that it is yet. So that's that Resus Council update. We're still sort of going through the Resuscitation Council information. There's not really that much that has changed on compressions. There's a few minor things about when you give adrenaline. So we will be updating our documents. Probably that release will come out probably in about 3 months' time. So that'll be sort of our autumn release where we'll release some new documents around that. We've just released an isolation protocol update. The rules around isolation and self-isolation seem to be changing every 2 or 3 weeks. So we'll work on the document and then just as we've been about to release it, there's been another change. So it's rapidly changing, but we've kind of got it up to date and we've released that. So I'd advise all practices. There was a small error in it that we corrected as well. So apologies for the error. It does happen sometimes, but with that isolation protocol update, that's out now in the system. And I would update to that and roll that out across your teams. We're working on a brand new disability access audit. George, who is fantastic, who's on the compliance team, has been working with an external expert. He's really, really experienced, this guy called Ian. And we are going to have a new disability access audit, which we're also going to digitize in the same way that we've digitized the the other audits, the infection prevention control audit, and we're going to get that out there. But we're also going to do a CPD course on the iLearn, and we're going to do a webinar. So the next webinar at the end of July will be sort of disability access education for a practice manager. Because I don't know about anyone else, but I personally always found it's one of the toughest areas of compliance, because how wide do the doors need to be? Do I need to put up tactile wallpaper? What are the priorities here? What is a reasonable adjustment? So I think it's really good to give some education on that. Just out of pure interest, in the chat box, whilst I'm just sort of, what have you guys, how are you finding the new digital audits? Is anyone using the infection prevention audit? What do you think of that? I'd really be interested if you chat in the public chat and let me know what you think. Oh, sorry, one second. Right. Okay. So the what else have we got? Antimicrobial audit. We're looking at, there's been new antimicrobial guidance that came out, I think it was tail end of last year. The guy that wrote the guidance for the FGDP, we've asked him to have a look at our documents and just see what we can do with our audit, etc. And the iComply focus groups are, for those of you who've been following these webinars, we've been engaging. You know, we don't always think we've got it right. We've got a fantastic company here, which is brilliant, of Isopharm and Code coming together as Agilio, and there's more practice managers and practice consultants in this business than I've ever worked with before, and it's just absolutely brilliant, the teams here. And but we know we don't always get it right, and we're not always getting it right. We know that we can always do better. So we've been chatting to multiple groups of users, people who love us, people who have really good feedback for us, and just chatting to find out what can we do to make these products better for you. So that focus group is coming to an end very shortly, and we're going to have feedback, and then we're going to look at, well, what can we do? I mean, one of the key pieces of information we got was that people felt that the comparison editor, when you update to a new version of a document, could be better. So we're doing work on that, and there will be the option of just not bothering with the comparison editor, actually just throw away version 14. If we've released version 15, just adopt version 15 fresh, so you don't even have to have a comparison editor. So we've had some really good feedback on that, and we just want to do more and more. We want to tackle, you know, I'd say it's an aggressive roadmap of development for the product to make it fantastic for you. But what we're also looking at is we're looking at what's still in there and how we can improve, refine, make it better for everyone. I'm loving the feedback that everyone's saying. Everyone's finding information there from Ever. Ever said, brilliant, so easy to use, and very professional, the audits. Well, thank you very, very much. Someone said about Isopharm logbooks. Obviously, logbooks, Druti, like logbooks versus audits, I think if you're understanding it, are different. Like, your logs are where you're logging the information, whereas your audits are where you're doing the big audit, where you're checking the information gathering. But we can, you know, give us a call to chat about that if you remember. No problem. Okay, so now just a little bit on the roadmap, just to give some clarity on that. Obviously, we've done the single sign-on. We've had the intelligent audit tool. You'll be really happy to know that we're now working on the audits phase two, X-ray clinical records auditing and X-ray quality auditing, and making that intelligent. I won't go too deep into this slide, but you can see we're looking at digital logs and checklists coming up, policy, send and read and sign, significant events management, how we can handle complaints management in the system, but how we can digitize all of this stuff for you and make it far easier. And the stuff on the left is the stuff that you've probably already seen in the system. So I am now going to move on to the DSP toolkit. So the content of today is, what is the DSP toolkit and who needs to do it? I'm going to cover the key changes between the 2020 and the, sorry, the 2019, 2020 and the 2020-2021 toolkit. I'm going to talk about data security clauses. This is one of the biggest things, which, as I was saying earlier, is this is one of the things that you need to do in order to actually comfortably say to the toolkit, you have met this standard. And this is a new, well, a more developed standard, as you'll see. They've gone more prescriptive on what they want from you, which means you need to do some work, which most likely involves reissuing amendment letters on your contracts, or just reissuing contracts or issuing new contracts in order to meet this requirement of the DSP toolkit. We're going to talk about bringing your own device, data protection impact assessments, smartphones, public Wi-Fi usage, and the other big one is the continuity plan testing, is that you need to be able to say what you've done to test the data security aspects of your business continuity plan, which means number one, you need a business continuity plan that contains data security and protection aspects, which ours does, and then you need some way of testing that, and we've released a document to help you test that. So as long as you've got the documents, you should be fine. But obviously, if you don't have our system, I'll talk about how you could do that. You are running out of time to do that. So what is the DSP toolkit? I think it's just important, just in case people don't know what it is. So I'll just read straight from the top. The Data Security and Protection Toolkit is an online self-assessment tool. It's basically an audit that you have to do that allows organizations to measure their performance against the National Data Guardian's 10 data security standards. All English organizations that have access to NHS patient data must do it. And so it's essentially anyone who's got an NHS mail account. So it's generally if you have an NHS contract, or if you're referring into the NHS using an NHS mail account, so if you're a private practice, then you need to do the DSP toolkit. If you were a private practice and you did the entry level toolkit previously, you now need to do the full toolkit for this year. Unless you managed to sneak in up till about 2 months ago, a month and a half ago, you could still do the entry level, but they've taken that away now. So unfortunately, if you're too late for that, if you did it the year before, so you now need to do the full toolkit. Not if you're using something like Rego and you're using those systems. It's if you're an NHS practice handling patient data, or if you're using the if you have an NHS mail account and you're referring. It's an annual assessment, as it says on that bottom bullet. And the interesting thing here is, as data security standards evolve, the requirements of the toolkit are reviewed and updated. So what this means is every single year, the NHS digital team reissue this and they change the standards, they reword them. And it's kind of as data security and protection evolves, because if they kept sort of static standards, then, you know, there's always ways and means that people will find of using your data that don't necessarily mean that meet these standards. So the data security standards will evolve. We got GDPR in, but then these are the standards. These are almost above, they sit alongside / above GDPR, because they're the NHS rules that you have to follow with your data and you've got to say you're doing. And you'll see they actually go, some of these standards are higher than GDPR that the NHS expects from you and you have to do. So I'll point out a couple of those when we get to those as well. So why do you have to do it? Well, basically, it's necessary to have access to NHS. It's necessary for compliance with your NHS contract, and also to have access to the NHS mail. It's part of the terms and conditions. It's also Department of Health and Social Care policy. And so there's a lot of reasons that you have to do it, but you do have to do it. So what happens if you don't do it? If you don't do it, then your name gets published on a list. You can go to the website right now, the DSP Toolkit website, and I can't remember the section of the website, but you can look on there and see practices, dental practices that are compliant or not compliant. The NHS digital team do say that they pass this data to the CQC every single year. They say that. Whether they have ever done it or the CQC have ever acted upon it, I don't know. But I personally, if it was my practice, I wouldn't want to take that risk. And I don't mind taking risks, but that's not a risk I would like to take, is that because if it's just giving an inspector, well, not that an inspector's looking to catch you out, but it's just a clear example of what does it say about your culture and you as a leader or your practice if you are choosing not to do this? What would that say to the CQC? What would that trigger to them about you? maybe wouldn't cause an inspection, but it would maybe make the risk rating of your practice go higher on their system and make it more likely that you're going to get an inspection. And this stuff is regulated by the CQC. It's quite interesting because I spoke to someone once and they went, well, the CQC don't come in and look at this. There's nothing on the CQC inspection reports about information governance or whatever. And that's because the CQC, the ICO are the regulator of this. The CQC do have a quick look at it, but what they would do is the CQC, if they saw that you weren't doing it, if they had a quick look and saw you weren't doing it, then they'd maybe have a bit of a deeper look. And then if they felt that there's a problem, what happens then is then they have a relationship with the ICO where they will call them up and go, this particular practice isn't doing it. So just because the CQC has a quick look at something and goes, that's okay, don't think that you don't need to be doing the other 90% that they haven't looked at. It just means that you've assured them. Whereas if you didn't assure them, then they'd probably go the other way with it. I hope that makes sense, because I was talking to someone about this the other day, and that was, I think, it was a very smart question from them. Okay, so tips for completing the assessment. As I said before, complete it each year as they publish your answers and they share the non-compliance. Only answer the mandatory questions. There is a lot of compliance that we have to do, or things that we have to do to evidence compliance with regulation. I really don't like the word compliance, because we don't do compliance. We do quality assurance. We keep our policies up to date. And a lot of this is just to evidence that we are complying, meeting regulations and guidance. So there's a lot that we have to do each year to generate this evidence, which we're always trying to keep. You know, our team here, one of our main jobs is to try and keep that as minimal and as streamlined for our members as possible. Also for us, because anything that we put in the system, we have to keep up to date as well. So only answer the mandatory questions. Someone, our guide that we have, that you will see, there's a guide that we make for this, and there's a sample of it in the downloads. We only do the mandatory questions, and occasionally someone will ring us up and say, you've not done all the questions, it's an incomplete guide. And that's because we don't put the non-mandatory ones in, because you don't have to do them. And with the amount of stuff that we have to do, we're not going to give you guidance on how to do something that you don't have to do. And also, there's no one out there. So one practice has said to me in the past, well, we want to do everything to best practice and it's great. And I want to say, well, you know, when you're doing that, what are you spending? What could you be spending time on that would be great for your business or would be great for your PR? Because no one in the NHS is going to look at this and go, they're fantastic, they're great, we're going to consider them better. So I wouldn't, if you want to show best practice in any area, I just wouldn't do it on the DSP toolkit, if that makes sense. Now, read the questions carefully as they change each year. Ask the question asked and only the question asked. I think that's really important with any audit. You don't need to go beyond and volunteer any information. This is the really most important one, is prepare with plenty of time. So if you're not an iComply member and you have policies, procedures, contracts, logs, you know, things that are there to help you evidence that you're meeting the requirements of the DSP toolkit, when the DSP toolkit changes, those things need to change. Your policies need edits to them. Your contracts need reissuing or need clauses adding to them. That's the job that we do for our members. And that's the job that we've done, January, February. And that took us a good month to 6 weeks to actually go through it with a fine tooth comb and decide, and sort of do a gap analysis against our documents and then decide what changes we need to make in order to be able to issue those new templates to our members. So if someone is sat there right now and you're thinking, you know, wow, that's a lot of work, there's a lot for us to do in the next 4 weeks, just get ready, then obviously now's a good time to have a conversation with us. There's a document there that you can have a look at, the sample of what we do in the system, and you can and someone should hopefully put a link up on the page that you could book a demo and have a chat with our team, and they could show you some of the DSP toolkit stuff we've got in there, and you could see whether or not you feel like our approach is a good fit with your business. Oh, and they're doing a free digital health kit check as well with it. So that's fantastic. And if you are a code member, you can use the code guide. Sorry, the Agilio guide. That's a hangover. I should have put Agilio in there. So I do apologise. That will, if anyone's listening in from our management team, I'm sorry about that as well. The Agilio guide. M217A to identify tasks that you may need to perform or documents you may need to do to update in order to be able to answer the toolkit by the deadline. So moving on from that, so key changes between the 2020, the 2019-20 and the 2020-2020 one toolkits are, well, if you look at the, you'd initially think that this makes it look easier. There's 56 mandatory prompts and 12 uploads in last year's toolkit, the one we had to do by September. For this year's, the one we need to complete by the 30th of June, you have 45 prompts and one or two updates. So you would think this is easier. And we did initially, when we looked at it, we went, oh, brilliant, fantastic. This is going to be an easier piece of work. What we then realized is that they've basically rewritten every single prompt. They've merged the prompts together. So some of them have merged. Quite a lot more of the answers need to be a lot more descriptive. So before they were asking for 12 uploads, because the way they think they were looking at it is they were just like, do you have a policy on this? You say yes, you stick the policy in there, and then someone in their team would probably have a look at it to verify your toolkit if they're doing spot checks or anything like that. Now, obviously the manpower behind that would be huge for the NHS digital team to have to look at all of this stuff. And I imagine what they realize is that's not really going to happen. It's not practical. So they're asking you to do one or two uploads. The one upload is your information governance procedures. The second upload that you have to do is a, it's probably a good thing to mention on that, is a plan that you need to put in place to explain what you're going to do if you've got any legacy software. So if you're using, say, I think Windows 7 is no longer supported, I can't remember, but if you're using legacy software, old versions of Microsoft Windows, old versions of Microsoft Word that are not supported anymore, which basically means they're not getting security patches, which means you've got big holes in your software that hackers could get through and could put ransomware on your computer, they want you to explain why. They want you to justify it to them. Now, obviously, we've not given a document for that at Agilio because we do not believe in, we believe you should not have legacy software in a business that is processing patient data. So it's very, very sensitive, and you need to have your software up to date. It doesn't mean you need to be using the latest software. You just need to find which ones are still getting security patches. So going back to what I was saying is they're asking you to upload a lot less because they're asking you to describe a lot more in your answers and give a lot more information than just yes or no. So answers, as I said, need to be more descriptive in places. Some of the standards are more prescriptive. They've introduced some new standards, and the deadline's moved to the 30th of June. So to give an example of where they're being more, they'd like you to be more descriptive. And this is probably the most extreme example, and this is the one that I was saying to you at the beginning of the webinar. You really need to bear this in mind, because this is not a small job that you're probably going to need to do between now and sometime, probably a week before. So you've probably got 3 weeks or so now to get on top of all of this, and maybe then a week to do the toolkit if you're not on top of it. So the 2020 version on the left just said, now explain how your data security and incident response management has been tested to ensure all parties understand the roles and responsibilities. And the prompt detail was, this should be in the last 12 months. And last year, you could just upload a document and you could say a little bit about it. But this year, they've gone very, very prescriptive with what they want. So they said, describe how your organization, so how does your organization test the data and cybersecurity aspects of its business continuity plan? So they've been very specific about, you must have a business continuity plan. Well, in the code, sorry, the iComply system we do, that's M255, that's your disaster plan and emergency procedures. And it's got to contain data and cybersecurity aspects. Now we have that. That document needs to be kept off site, by the way, just in case you don't have a copy at home, because it's kind of like what would happen if the practice, if there was a fire in the practice. And obviously, if you can't access the plan, well, you could have it digitally in iComply as well, because it's in the cloud, but it's a good idea to have a paper copy as well. But that plan actually has a whole, M255 has a whole load of sections in it. What would you do if you had ransomware? What would you do if you got hacked? What would you do? So we've got the scenarios with what you should do. Now, what they're now asking you to do is describe how your organization tests these aspects of the plan, and more critically, what was the outcome of the exercise the last time you did it, and that must be since the 1st of April 2020. And most practices I've spoken to haven't done this, have never done this, or never done it formally. So we have created a new document in iComply, which is the data and cybersecurity test log, which basically you need to carry out these tests between now and June. You need to record your results, your actions, keep them on file, and you might need to update your continuity plan first before you do the test and train your team on the update to your continuity plan if you're using an old version or if you've just never put one in place or if you're new to our system. And then obviously we've said that you can use the new data and cybersecurity test log, which is M217. I think I put the wrong code on that. I do apologize. It's M217X, not M217C. So going back, you know, where it says, what was the outcome of your plan exercise the last time you did it? If you've gone through this process, then you will be able to answer that question with confidence and submit that answer on June the 30th to or before June the 30th as part of filling out the toolkit. So that's probably the second most significant thing in the toolkit that has changed this year. Right, so being more prescriptive, and this is actually the other big thing that has changed. So the, we've got these the other way around. So the one on the right was is the 2021 and the one on the left is the 2021 one. So the, all they said last year was, do all employment contracts and volunteer agreements contain data security requirements? And literally the answer was, yes, they do. So everyone last year went, yes, our contracts are fine with this. That's fine. Now, what they've said this year, which is the one on the left, which is, do all employment contracts and volunteer agreements contain data security requirements? Now, the prompt details where they're being more prescriptive. And this is quite interesting because I've spoken to this about with data security experts who we have on our team and external consultants, and everyone's in agreement that this is above and beyond the GDPR requirement. GDPR doesn't require this from practices, but the NHS does, and they're clarifying what they need from you, and you need to confirm that you've done this when you submit your toolkit at the end of June. So clauses in contracts and agreements should reference data security, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Many contracts just commonly focus on confidentiality, which ours did. And I think pretty much every contract you'll see out there up until this year when this has come in as a requirement has not ever really spoken about data integrity or data availability. So your organization's staff employment contracts, volunteer agreements, etc., have to have an updated clause on data security. So we've done this. We've released new versions of our contracts. I think it was in March that contained these clauses. If you're on the previous version of our contracts, then we've released an employed and a self-employed amendment letter, so you don't have to reissue the whole contract to just say we're adding these clauses. So that's nice and clean. If your contracts were particularly old, or were more than one version old, you're going to need to adopt these new contracts and issue them to your team and get signatures in order to, if you want to answer on the 30th of June that you've done this and you're compliant with this standard. So just giving a bit of information around that is obviously confidentiality. I think we all know what data confidentiality is, and it's that data is protected from unauthorized or unnecessary viewing, access, and or sharing. Integrity and availability don't seem to have a standard agreed definition, but these are the best sort of summaries that I've come up with, which is integrity is about the data is being entered correctly. So if you get a medical history form or a new patient form and you're just entering in the wrong data, that's obviously not a great thing. And it's obviously the data is entered correctly and then it's protected from unauthorized changes. So how do you make sure that that you've not got people editing the data when they shouldn't? And then obviously that any changes are reliable, they are accurate. Availability is about authorized people having access to the data they need at the time that they need it as well, that it's timely, that they can get hold of it when they need it to help with a patient. And it's also that it is protected as well, so that it's not just available to everybody. Those with administrator access need to be held to a higher level of accountability because they may have access to a lot of sensitive information. And as I said, there we've released new contracts and agreements to help people with that. And that says next week, but that those are in the system, absolutely. So those are your two major things, which I've said at the beginning, is that, and obviously that's quite a bit of work if you're not a member, because you may need to edit, come up with these clauses yourself, or you need to figure out, I've got to do a business continuity plan, and now I've got to do a test against it and everything. So if you are interested in becoming a member, the DSP toolkit is generally a good reason to come on board with us, and someone will flash up a link so you can book a demo and chat to the team and have a look at what we're doing with that. But we've done all the hard work for you. It's a big piece of work that we do every single year for our members with a full gap analysis and figuring out anything we can cut from the system or add from the system as well. So hopefully that link will pop up in a second, but this is just a quick one in the smartphones. If you're using smartphones, this isn't people's own phones. This is if you are issuing smartphones. So if you're a practice manager and you have a work iPhone that you've been given, or if the principal has an iPhone that is technically a work phone that's owned by the business rather than the principal, then you need to have procedures in place around this. And this generally along the lines of that they're all locked by PIN, fingerprint, facial scan. We've recommended you register them with the National Property Register. Probably a good idea to put mobile device management software on them, which means if somebody did quit or leaves or something like that, you can actually, or the phone gets stolen, you can remotely wipe that phone. And all phones have tracking apps installed as well, which, I mean, generally iPhones and Android have it built into them anyway. But you need this written into your policies and your procedures, and and you want to do sort of random spot checks, etc. So we've built this into our M217C, our procedures document. So it's just a touch on the beefing up the requirements around smartphones. DPIA and Wi-Fi, just a little one in that what they've said previously is, actually I'm trying to remember the prompt. What does it say now? It was more, I've not got the old prompt here, but the old prompt was a lot less descriptive, whereas this one about data protection impact assessments, which are generally impact assessments you do. Well, actually, I'll read what it says there. It says your policy should describe the process that your organization has in place to make sure that it systematically identifies and minimizes the data protection risks of any new project or any plan that involves processing personal data. So you need to have, even if you're never going to do this, you need to have a procedure in place of what you would do. The ICO has really good guidance on this as well. And we've built this into our M217C that says these are the steps that we'd go through if we needed to do a major, the sort of things you'd do this for in practice would be installing CCTV, because you'd need to justify what you're going to do, how long you're going to keep the data for, you know, the potential surveillance criticisms you could get from your teams if you're putting cameras in certain places, and also something like a major data move. So if you're transferring from one patient software to another, there are risks inherent there in losing the data or the security around that data. One of the next ones, just a simple one that you can cover off in a policy, is have staff, directors, trustees, and volunteers basically been advised not to use public Wi-Fi on work computers, work anything that could have sensitive data or could allow a hacker through an unsecured network, or someone could allow someone to get access to that patient data. Bring your own device. Okay, so this is really interesting, because what we're seeing, you know, we have the iComply app and we're going to be developing on that. But what we're seeing is a lot of practices are allowing their team to use their own phones for certain things. For maybe you've got a rota software, maybe you've got something that's your team are logging in on. So you need to have a bring your own device policy in place, and you need to be able to have evidence of how this policy is reinforced. So we've just put a procedure in place that recommends every 6 months or so you check certain things around the bring your own device. So I think it's along the lines of there's fingerprint locking in there, that there is a key code on it. It's all written into the policy and procedure, but it's very important to make sure that there is a policy around that and how you keep those secure. Okay, so it's those are the main points for the webinar today. So what we've covered is, what is the DSP toolkit and who needs to do it? Essentially, if you've got an NHS contract or you have an NHS mail account or a private practice with an NHS mail account, you've got to do this every single year, and the consequences of not doing it are that the CQC is given that information. Whether the CQC does anything with that information, I don't know historically, but it's obviously you probably don't want something out there that's a big red flag that you've not done a job that you're supposed to do. The key changes, we covered those in detail. Mostly it's about the standards being, you're having to upload less documents. The standards have become more prescriptive. They're kind of raising the bar. The standards are evolving, and as they're evolving, they're becoming a bit more prescriptive. They're saying, okay, well, you have to do these things. Where they were maybe a bit vague before, they're saying you have to do these things. You've got to add those data security clauses. As I said below, you must do this test against your business continuity plan. So your business continuity plan has to cover data security, and you have to test against it. And it must have happened since April last year. So they're making it more prescriptive. They're making you upload less, but they're making you make your answers more descriptive. Obviously, our template covers that in that we've given sort of template answers that you can then expand upon. So hopefully, we've taken some of the hard work out of that for you. The continuity plan testing, as you said, and the data security clauses are the biggest thing that there are. And then there's smaller points around bring your own device policies, having a detailed process for data protection impact assessments, smartphone security, and public use of public Wi-Fi. So those are your key points for that webinar. For the webinar. So next steps. I think it's always important for sort of next steps, you know, check your toolkit login. If you've not done it so far, make sure you've got one, make sure you still know you might need to do a password reset. If you've not, you know, well, actually, even if you have iComply, read the questions very, very carefully, as they are asking specific things and they change each year. And what we're giving you is a template, but, you know, it's important. And the Data Protection Act and GDPR does put the precedence on the practice to have someone competent and trained to do this. So to be honest, if that's something you don't have, maybe you want to look at some of the training that we've got in the iLearn platform on data protection. There is a responsibility to have a competent person on site. Perform, if you're not using iComply, you're going to want to perform a comprehensive gap analysis between all of the sort of evidence, policies, procedures, logs, continuity plans you have now, and the requirements in the prompts, the updated prompts, to obviously make sure that the two align, make the edits, train your team, issue your new contracts if you need to. Only answer the mandatory questions, as I've said. We've got enough to do without managing. We've got enough to do without answering the non-mandatory questions, and also, that it's not something where you going above and beyond is going to make any significant impact on how the NHS or how somebody views you. There's different ways you can achieve that. And submit your assessment before the 30th of June.